break time is over. You may continue.
Commissioners, maybe before, before we move on to that, I just crossed something off the to-do list that you gave me, which is what are the Leonard fees? What you might want to do is pull out your impact fee study section, and I'll read them off to you. The town of Leonardtown's impact fees total $21,388. It consists of Board of Ed for $3,375, water connection for $1,530, water impact fee for $1,800, sewer connect for $1,683, and sewer impact for $13,000. So you can see that the one common element is Board of Ed, 3375, you know, no contribution toward parks or roads.
They give to us, $3,375.
Right. And they probably set that based on the fact that we said that 3375.
And their total impact is 21?
21,388. And I'll send an email out to you, but I just, you know, the other ones are probably more relevant to a comparison or consideration on the Metcom side. Now, in the interest of it being 426, and we've gotten through one page.
Yeah.
Thorough.
Yeah. No, that's good. That's good. And we can slow down or speed up as needs be. But if we go to page 3, right, which is highways, we thought that maybe one of the ways that we could do it is if you take a look at highways and if there are particular projects that you have questions or direction on, George is there to answer your questions or take your direction. You know, and then we'll move through each page kind of on that basis.
Okay.
Rather than a line by line by line.
Got it, nice.
So looking at page 3 in this schedule, you can see what the changes are to the 2015 plan. FDR, Patuxent Park Neighborhood, retrofit sidewalk, the water quality and nutrient removal, Southampton revitalization, which is really bringing it onto the page, and the CSM interparcel access road. Are there particular projects that you want to talk about?
FDR Boulevard. Now, looks like we're not in I see we've moved $2,205,000 out, and it looks like we'll pick it up in 2018. It doesn't seem like we're in a position to leave $3,795,000 in there because we're not going to spend it, is my point. We're not going to acquire any land, are we?
The purpose of the $2.8 million in unexpended land balance is to purchase land for phase 3, as I mentioned earlier.
I understand, but
the design's not done on phase 3, so that wouldn't be able to happen until at least FY16. So that's money that's in the prior unexpended balance that won't actually be expended until the design's done sometime this year. We have a purchase requisition with State Highway. Their real estate folks agreed to help us on phase 1 as well as phase 3, and that's where we stand with that.
Okay, what I'd like to say is FDR Boulevard, a phase that's been out of the program for a long time is phase 4. That's Peg Road to Great Mills Road.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, recently, the people from Brian Norris and his company said they'd be willing to build a section of that road from Valley Drive almost over to where it comes behind the Peg Road Shell Station on the corner, Peg Road and 235. There's about 400 feet of property there that would have to be purchased, donated, somehow negotiated to be able to make a connection between Peg Road and Valley Drive. I'd like us to look at that owner is the estate of David Millison, lives in Norfolk, Virginia. I'd like us to look into the possibility of approaching his estate about buying that piece of property, which would give us connection from Peg Road to Valley Drive. Now, from Valley Drive, on down into Great Mills Road. Next, you run into the area behind, we actually have a right-of-way. It's behind where Avis and Enterprise are located. The tackle box is there. That landowner has agreed to donate whatever he needs to donate for FDR Boulevard, as long as we would give him access onto it. Again, it would be free. Access through the Millicent Corporate Center, and speaking with those people, they are agreeable to donating that for FDR Boulevard. There is a parcel down a little further owned by Crossroads Construction. That's been a challenging piece. They had an appraisal done of about $1.4 million. They're willing to sell that now for $525,000. That would give us the ability, if we bought that piece of property for $525,000 and the piece behind the Peg Road, to get all the land we need from Peg Road to Great Mills Road. So my thought is it's probably in the $600,000 range. Can we use some of the money currently allocated for acquisition of land in phase three to secure these pieces of property in phase four?
You want an answer? The answer is the board can certainly do that. It's a section of roadway, as you pointed out, is not in the CIP, which is not insurmountable. I would only submit that if you don't have a design, I wouldn't unequivocally say that we would be able to obtain all the property that we would need to construct the roadway.
I agree with that. But the thing is, we have very limited wiggle room in the alignment of that
Correct.
Road. So it would appear that if we were to purchase property, we would use it if we build the road. But what we could do is we could secure the asset. We could get it at a decent price and have it for future CIP expansion versus letting it go and see what happens and then the prices go up. But I think it's an opportunity with, I think it's called Cherry Cove Development, to want to do their section, that we can kind of partner in on this thing. If we can buy those other two properties, we can put it in our CIP for later. There could even be a breakout project to do the part behind the Shell station. That would give us connection between. Now, we're told by state highway figures that the amount of traffic, you would think it would be a lot less, because a lot of Gate 1 turns right and goes north on 235 or go straight across Peg Road. But we're told the traffic count from Great Mills Road to Peg Road on 235 is 38,000 cars a day. Still right. quite a bit of traffic. So I guess what I'd like to say is we look at some of the money allocated for land acquisition in phase three and look at the feasibility of acquiring these pieces in phase four, so that we have them under our belt, we have them under control. And then I'd bump out another year on FDR to probably 2019, because you need to get your engineering done.
I would say, you know, for the last 4 years I've been advocating FDR to try to alleviate the problem we have on 235. And I've been disappointed that we haven't been able to move faster on it, but it is what it is. I would say that, you know, when we looked at the cost from St. Andrew's Church Road to Peg Road and the cost of Peg Road to Great Mills Road, there was a huge disparity in cost and distance, only because of land acquisition and things like that. And Mr. Norris also talked to me about the little strip of land there to get down there to from Peg to Valley. My biggest concern here is that we haven't built a new road in this county in probably 25 years. And we've come a long ways to get to the point we're at right now. And I would very much hate to lose what momentum we have to get St. Andrew's Church Road, FDR from St. Andrew's Church Road to Peg Road, to start thinking about how we will go from Peg Road into Lexington Park, because it was arduous here the last 4 years to get the chunks figured out. And once we figure out the chunks, we figure, okay, go gate one, maybe up to Sanders Church Road, alleviate the traffic off 235, which was the biggest bottleneck, and then be able to use that for other types of traffic flow and circulation. So I said, I'm really reluctant to move further down towards Great Mills Road, not having assurances that we're going to finish the piece we started and it will have chunks again, rather than a continuous flow of traffic from St. Andrews down the Peg Road, and then worry about the other pieces that you refer to at another point in time.
But it leaves money in the budget that's not going to be used because the design's not ready. The other part, the phase four, is such that there's really not any other way to design that road. Now, phase three, I'm like you. I don't understand why design takes so long, but I guess it's got something to do with wetlands or crossings or whatever it has to do with, so it doesn't make sense to leave money sitting somewhere when it's allocated to be used.
I guess the question that I would ask rhetorically is, what assurances do we have that in 2 years we're going to put the money back into the budget to finish building the piece from Sanders Church Road to Peg Road if we're going to yank this money? Because yeah, I understand where you're coming from, but I mean, I believe for numerous traffic reasons and numerous infrastructure reasons and the Cobra model and all that stuff, that road has got to get finished before we can continue to think of moving down towards the Great Mills area. I think that's the reason George originally put it in pieces and parts to, you know, do this in chunks, so before we would add more chunks, for lack of a better word, finish the chunks we got started. That's just, you know, after doing this for so long.
I don't disagree with you. I mean, I think it's we want to keep things on track. I guess one of the points I think it's been pretty impressive that, you know, you talk about public-private partnerships. I mean, the fact that you've got families are willing to play into this and some companies are willing to take some role in this game, I guess to me, $600,000 isn't chump change, but if you could solve the land acquisition problem for phase four with $600,000, I think you're doing pretty good.
That's a heck of a buy. Yeah, no doubt.
I'm not saying push anything out. I'm saying we should take advantage of that if it's a reality that we could get the land acquisition for that.
Yeah, if we're saying push harder and faster to make sure that it can actually be done in the future, then, you know, especially at that.
Mr. Archer, what delay would this put if we did something like this? Would you anticipate a delay into this? Or?
Well, it's less about the timing than it is, you know, not knowing all the parcels, because phase four has been off the table for so many years, whether some of these owners are talking about full acquisitions of their parcel when, I'll say, in the public interest, we may not need the entire parcel. Now, having said that, if you render the balance of the parcel with your right-of-way and your easements useless, that ends up being part of the appraisal and the negotiation process. But without having a design, which I've been always been an advocate of having the design up front so you can make these decisions about land. With phase four not having any design, except for the tight corridor that, I mean, you and I have even sat down and looked at it. It's not a lot of wiggle room, if you will, to this corridor, but there are easements, grading, temporary, permanent. There are plats that we would have to do. You know, there are appraisals we'd have to do. There's still a process we'd have to go through. As far as a delay, phase three is the next land acquisition piece. As long as the phase three land acquisition monies are reprogrammed back in when they're needed, and I'm suggesting that could be as early as FY16, you've gained 4 or 5 months, maybe, in the process. I don't know that there's been a lot gained by that.
I'm saying to you, if you're talking about FY16, you're not even talking about having your design done until sometime in FY16.
So understood, but sometime...
If your design's not done.
Sometime during 16, the anticipation is that we'll be able to start exercising our contract with SHA to start doing the acquisition. So whether it's December or January of that fiscal year, we want to be in a position to do that. So maybe it's not all of it, maybe it's a portion of it, which you might be suggesting, but the thought is that maybe we reprogram whatever comes out in the year that we think we're going to use it, whether it be 16 or 17. And I think that might address some of your concerns about taking it out as an unexpended and never reprogramming it. So maybe that can be done in sync.
Well, my other question here is, wait, we have engineered and designed different sections of the FDR Boulevard starting up at Sanders Church Road at the present time, correct?
Correct.
what prohibits partial construction starting from the St. Andrew's Church Road and working its way down while we're working on the engineering design and acquisition closer to Peg Road?
Nothing.
So then, when you're looking at the monies, would that money, the monies that you're proposing to take out, still be able to be used for construction? So we can at least show the public we're making progress to get this road built versus trying to, you know, take on is. I'm not opposed to what Commissioner Hewitt says. I just think there, for a bunch of traffic reasons and a bunch of, you know, looking to the future reasons, I really believe we got to get that road built sooner rather than later.
So what you're saying essentially would be FDR Boulevard, MD4 to Great Mills Road, start construction and the other phase.
I would say that we have, there's three pieces from St. Andrew's Church Road to Peg Road.
Right.
The top piece from St. Andrew's, I'll say, to Rolling Road down to Chancellor's Run Road, and then Chancellor's Road to Peg Road. It's Chancellor's to Peg Road thereabouts that still remains acquisition and design, correct, George? But the piece starting at St. Andrew's Church Road and working down to Rolling Road and then working down to Chancellor's Run is just waiting to be. I would sit there and say, I'm assuming we're just waiting to start the build process. Is that a fair statement?
There's one small piece. There's the wetland mitigation section on the middle piece. On the piece from Route 4 to Old Rolling Road, there's nothing there that's holding us up. That's the piece we want to build first. We just don't want to make the connection to Old Rolling Road until the next piece of Old Rolling Road is done, because we don't want to dump all that traffic onto Old Rolling Road. You'll have an issue on Old Rolling Road. So there's nothing that precludes that piece from starting. And the plan there is to get draft solicitation documents going forward on that piece. You got the second piece, which is the Old Rolling Road to what I'll call Kinnegad, which is where our wetland crossing is, and we're in the process of getting that wetlands permit process completed. And then you have Kinnegad Drive, which is basically the Amber Drive piece, all the way down to 237. There's one property issue left there. It really is just a matter of ownership is all it is. It's complicated, as our county attorney will attest to. It's whether or not a single entity owns it or several entities own it, and that's simply a matter of resolving that and getting all the owners to sign. It happens to be in a location where we have a planned roundabout. Could we build the road without a roundabout? Absolutely. One of the conditions of getting concurrence from the HOAs down there is that we have those roundabouts in place. So I wouldn't recommend that we go forward without it until we have that property piece addressed. That's just my thought. But it does put FY16 as your year to get land acquisition, begin the land acquisition in phase three, and puts phase three in 2017 and 2018. There's an unexpended balance in the current budget to start the phase one construction, and there's also unexpended monies in the current balance for phase three acquisition that we don't need right now.
So, Mike, is that what you're talking about, the money in the phase three to go ahead and acquire for phase four?
The land acquisition, those two pieces.
But we'd still be able to start the construction on the St. Andrews side going to Rolling Rock with the money that's already allocated.
I just don't want to see, I don't want to see a delay in getting from point A to point B, which we've taken 4 years to get to start getting from point B to point C, which would be Great Mills Road. We're going to start messing around with the budget. I think we've got to start building, show the public we're committed to getting the job done, show, you know, the Navy and all the citizens we're concerned about getting this thing done and move forward with building our first road in 25 years.
And the closer you get to Great Mills Road, the more difficult that alignment is,
right.
Which would require really a little bit more than just a paper exercise of acquiring the land. You really need to look at it a little bit.
I guess to Commissioner Hewitt's point, I mean, if you've got a public-private partnership potential that's out there, we should definitely explore it. I'm not suggesting moving this away at all. I think we should keep moving forward.
The price for land acquisition is now.
Right.
Prices are down.
If we can start construction, like Commissioner Morgan was saying, and we can continue to do the planning, the building, and the acquisition, and use some of these funds to acquire the rest of it at the same time, I think that's a logical solution. And if we're talking $600,000, I mean, that's...
Who's the price of the museum?
Yeah.
What's the price of the museum?
So I think we might have solved it.
What's the timetable now on this wetland thing?
Because you want to go all the way to Peck Road. You don't want to stop at Rolling Road. I know you won't do that. So.
Well, you're asking me what I would like to do, and really.
what you would like to do.
That ship has sailed long ago on this project, as is others. But I think the project as planned and is currently laid out now makes sense to me from a timing standpoint. And actually, you know, I know Commissioner Morgan won't like it, but it pushes phase three out because the practicality of it is land won't be purchased in 15. Won't even be started till 16 because that's where the design is. With respect to the land acquisition, I'll just make an assumption that we're talking about full parcel acquisitions because there's no other way for me to sit here and and advise you otherwise because I wouldn't buy 12 acres of property if the swath that we need is only two.
Yes.
You know, just makes sense. So I'm assuming they would be full acquisitions. We'd still need to do plats. We'd still need to do exhibits. You would still have to authorize us through formal motion to do that, and we'd have to somehow include it in the description of this project.
George, could we just make it an FDR phase four and
You can do that too.
Yeah.
That includes estimates
which
for
is the declaration that you're open to the donation.
It just it at least would give us the opportunity to look into it.
Yeah, to look
I mean, today we have verbal agreements, right? That verbal doesn't buy anything in the legal sense of land acquisition. But
verbal's no good anymore.
If we've got folks on board who want to team with the county, then let's go down that road.
We have a phase four of the books already for this, don't we? It's not there, but it's design. It's on paper.
It's part of the alignment of the overall project, just as the piece is north of Route 4 that's being done by developers.
By the developer.
Right.
There's no design or anything right now for Phase 4.
Absolutely not.
And 30% of Phase 3 is not really done yet either.
Right. So the question is, do we put a new CIP together, describe it as a Phase 4, which makes some sense, cost it out, or simply just put land acquisition in 16, or talk about the unexpended balance and then reprogramming the unexpended balance. You see, it's the same amount of money either way.
Yep.
It's just how you do it. And the cleaner way to do it, I think, would be to create a phase four.
Please.
Right. It's bad enough.
Then, if we get to the end of the year and we have a change in the unexpended balances,
we can always do
that through the FIN. I mean, it just
we can do budget amendments and reshuffle the debt.
I think that
and
makes
then
sense.
And then it would be just a focus on the land acquisition.
Right.
That makes sense.
I can support a phase four as you described, as long as we're moving forward to start to build a phase one.
So this stays.
This stays.
Yes.
This project stays. There's now a new one for phase four land acquisition.
We definitely want to do the improvement to Peck Road for sure. We want to make sure that moves through. That's got to go through.
But knowing that when we're adding that phase four, that we're looking to hopefully be doing a readjustment, like you described, with any unexpended funds.
And there is on the Brian Norris piece, there is a 400-foot section. There's a 400-foot section that's not owned. And if Mr. Norris wants to come forward and build, there's got to be a design. And unless he is willing to design the entire connection to Peg Road, just cautioning you that when we go this route, there may still need to be some design money somewhere in the project. Mm-hmm. But let's at least get it to be a project first and then go forward from there.
Yeah. I can support it being a project as long as we have assurances we're starting to build phase one.
I think that's what I've heard is that we're building phase one and none of this is going to affect it. So
that's correct.
We go to two and then we go to three because you'll be doing three simultaneous with four, correct?
Well, there is
only doing the three. What's left to do of three? You'll be doing while we add four as a project
for land.
That's correct.
For land acquisition.
Okay, that's a fair statement. Yes.
Okay. Fair statement. Yeah, we're along that.
Is that the direction you were looking at, Mike?
We all think, Mike.
Yes.
That makes sense.
All right, I'm good now.
I'm good for that. Okay.
You're on line two.
Asphalt overlays, thank God.
Is the $3 million just a kind of a placeholder target that's common historically as you put in?
We've done that. Pricing has gone up and down over the years. What I can tell you is it's gone from 68 to 85 in the last three. We just had it rebid. I can't remember what the number is, but it's gone from 68 to 85 per ton. Historically, and I'll just rattle these off because I think it's good information. We used to do about 80 to 100 miles per year in overlays before 1998. Before 2005, we did 60 to 80 miles of overlays per year. Now we're doing about 50 to 55 overall. It was due to cost increases, et cetera, but.
How much needs to be done? 100 miles, 200 miles? Is 50 miles too much, too little?
We are doing a pavement condition assessment, which will be done this year.
Okay.
The last one that was done was 10 or 15 years ago. The last time it was done, we had, I think, an $8 million backlog somewhere in that neighborhood.
Mm.
As you catch up, as you try to catch up, which you can't take $8 million and catch up, you're having new enter the list of needs. And you're also accepting new roads, which, despite the economy, we still have projects on the books that are getting accepted. We'll be bringing forward to you another couple of miles we're accepting. We still accept 7 to 15 miles a year.
Okay.
Per year.
What's the average length of, I mean, if I gave you a road that was all done to your standards, how long would that last before it needs to be redone?
Depends on volume, right? Depends on volume and the quality of the materials used at the time. We do QAQC testing, but asphalt overlays, 20 to 25 years. Keep your fingers crossed. Modified surface treatment is a 5 to 7 year cycle.
Oh, 5 to 7.
You don't want to, despite modified seal being cheaper, it's probably not the best idea to take an asphalt road and convert it to modified seal. It's just probably not the best thing to do. And it is what it is in terms of price.
When you accept these, you've already been testing them and everything, or they built your specifications?
We approve the design. We do the materials testing. We accept them into our roadway system. Sometimes the subgrade is...
Yeah, you just never know for sure, yeah. I know you're doing the best you can on that, yeah.
Sometimes there's an elevated water table, things like that that we don't know about that starts to undermine it. You start to get alligator cracking if you don't address it. Next thing you know, you've got potholes, then you've got your base failure. If you don't address the surface,
I do a lot of base.
Okay, but it looks like you're spending the money. You got unfunded balance out of the $3 million of $45,202. So it looks like you're spending $3 million every year.
Yes, sir, and I can also tell you that there are many cases where an individual road is not done at one time, because the further you go back, the less of a volume there is. So when we do our assessment, we'll only do up to an intersection where we believe it's most necessary. Then we pick it up the subsequent year. That's not an easy tasking to deal with when you're talking about the residents in the neighborhood where you only did the first half of the road. So, you know, what I want to do, I think you asked earlier, would be to do the whole road. What makes the most sense is to apply the upgrades where they're needed and deal with the consequences and be able to explain yourself. And we've been able to explain ourselves, you know, despite them not necessarily liking it. They understand it. But you got to come back that next year or 2 years from now and finish it too, like you said you would. And we keep a pretty good list. Our inspectors are pretty good with that.
You did a good job on my street a couple years ago.
I have no idea where you live. I don't want to know. It's good to hear. It's good to hear.
No, they did. I'm sure it was county, but it was a good subcontract. Did a good
but
job.
But just so people know, every we bid out twice a year. We used to do it once. We used to do it once a year. We do it twice a year to encourage competition. Mm-hmm. And those lists are published on the website, so everybody knows what we're doing every time we do it. So it seems to be working. Now, could we use additional money? You always can, but if you're addressing your roads in the correct priority, you should be able to keep making some headway.
Anything else? Next.
Anything else on this page that you want to talk about?
Let me get down to that water, regional water quality nutrient. That's the rain tax, right? That says because we went over 100,000 people, we have to start addressing, trying to do something about it.
Yeah, the water quality or the waterway improvement program, the WIP, sort of superseded, kind of pushed that aside a little bit. What you're referring to is what's called an MS4 permit. It's called NPDES MS4 permit, and you're right, we do qualify as we speak, and any day now we could be advised that it's time for us to step up to the plate. Neither one of these projects have anything to do with that MS4 permitting that you're talking about, where we have to address 20% of our impervious area after 2001. We have to bring it up to the new standards. This is strictly watershed improvement planning, requirement from the state, passed down from the EPA, where the commissioner is only committed to a certain amount of capital expenditures, which are shown on sheets 39 and 40 and also 51 and 52. Why they're on two different sheets is because we were able to secure a grant back in September of 2014 for $2.6 million, which took $2.6 million of our mandate off the table, and with that came a strict time frame to get the work done. So with that grant came two things: one, a time frame, and also a commitment to the county to match. And what you're seeing on pages 39 and 40 is the county's commitment to that match.
So we have those funds. We have that.
Yes, statement. We're expending them as we speak. The second part of the project, which is later on pages 50 and 52, I believe, 51, 52, you'll see the majority of that construction is off the page. It's in balance to complete because they moved those requirements to the right for watershed implementation. So we likewise moved our capital expenditure off to the right. But we kept the design, and here's why we kept the design. Everything that we're doing for our water quality projects will also help us address that MS4 rain tap thing when it comes down. So everything we're doing here will be able to count as credit towards those projects. So we kept the design of the second phase of this in our current CIP. You'll see if we talk about page 50, 51, we kept the design in 2018 because we know by then the state's going to come down and tell us what it is we have to do.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll be poised.
By when?
2018 is when we show the balance of the design for our water quality work. Okay. Even though the water quality construction's off the page, I didn't move that to the right. My recommendation was not to move it to the right because we're going to need to be able to be responsible and responsive to this MS4 rain tax business when it comes.
Hopefully
down.
We'll get some relief from Governor Hogan.
Another reason why it's in 18. Let's allow for that time to happen, but if it doesn't happen,
it
we're...
It conceivably could be pushed towards us.
It could be pushed towards us, absolutely.
Absolutely.
I understand.
Absolutely. But we do qualify as we speak today, so to not have it at all in the CIP is probably not the smartest thing to do.
Okay.
But there is, I want to warn the commissioners, there is nothing in this capital budget that addresses the rain tax. This addresses the water quality, the watershed implementation plan. That's it. It just so happens that this work will also qualify for the initial phases of the MS4 permit. So it's money well spent, but it by no means addresses the rain tax at all. I didn't want you to leave with that impression.
Okay.
Are there any other projects on page 3 that you want to discuss? Okay, page 4, which is marine.
Could you... For years, the jetties have been a big issue, particularly the south end of the county. Is there a reason we're moving, except for federal funding, the jetty project to the right?
The project partnership agreement won't come till the spring of this year, and after that comes the design, and the feds are doing that, so that design will be in 16, so we're moving it to the right. But what I was hoping you would focus on is the fact that the federal program upped its limits
from
7
million
to 10, which is really good news as far as our responsibility for matching.
Right.
But the primary reason there, Commissioner Morgan, is simply the fact that the federal government is going to design it and the project partnership isn't in hand. Once you do sign it, that's when the design will start. They said spring of 2015. We're almost there. And, of course, last year we said fall of 2014.
The jetty project's big. When the citizens come and complain, the creek's filling in. We've had the jetty design, things like that. I want to make sure they understand that, if it fills in, it's not all our fault.
Well, and we did another emergency dredge as well.
We did the emergency dredge.
So I think we're being responsive on the local level, and this really is the permanent solution. It's just a very expensive solution.
Are we ready to go on to page 5?
Yes.
Land preservation. I didn't skip anything, did I? So Donna Sasser, come on down.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison.
Thanks, George.
Robin Finnicum's
coming. Oh, Robin, sorry.
Commissioners, you have two. The next CIP projects are related to land conservation, ag preservation, and like, and you'll see changes in the FY16 budget, dollar amount changes for each of them, which are both. One is a decrease in the agricultural land preservation program of $11,310, and the other is an increase of $5,000. And both of those changes in the dollar amount relate to what has either been collected that was less than projected or collected through ag transfer and other means, bringing in more than was projected. So it's not a fundamental change in the program at all. But we do have Donna Sasser, if you want to ask questions about the status of these projects. You had heard a presentation just, I think, the beginning of this month on the submission to the state for the Patuxent Tidewater Land Trust application for rural legacy funding that required you to make a decision in preference of the rural legacy area, either Mattapani or Huntersville, in terms of the state's funding. So, and at that time, she had discussed all the various dollars that come into funding these types of projects. It's fairly complicated, but it's spelled out here.
This is truly the source of my 11,310 variance, and I just kind of lost.
They found it.
I was not persistent. But I would also say that part of what we'll do, you know, what's not reflected on here necessarily is the cigarette restitution funds.
Right.
So one of the things that we're going to be working on in the next couple of weeks probably is recasting that, so that information is on this sheet as well, since it's another source of funding for land preservation.
And we'll have to come before you with a request to support a budget amendment. That's not an insignificant amount of money that'll change these CIP sheets. But we'll bring that together once we have all the paperwork together for you. Great. Thank you, Commissioner.
Okay, now we're moving on to page 6, which is Brian Lowy, Recreation and Parks, and then Public Landings at the bottom.
Welcome, Brian.
Afternoon. Evening now.
Commissioners, I guess here too, you know, looking at this page, are there particular projects that you have questions on? Do you want to go through the sequence?
Well, I'll go right down to Nicollet Park entrance. You know, I don't think that needs to be done yet because we don't own the land that that entrance would come out onto, which is this FDR Boulevard. So I would say if we can work out something with that landowner to somehow gain possession of that land, have it deeded to us, whatever, hold off on doing the Nicollet Park entrance until we have a clear path on that FDR Boulevard.
We're currently working on that scope of work for that that property exchange. The request for proposals is currently being developed, and we'll have that surveying work done hopefully in the near future.
Okay. The other one would be the Leonardtown Park, the next one.
Well, let's go back on Nicollet Park. I know that we have had this discussion a lot in the past, and that not only was it the desire to have the Nicollet Park opened up, but also it dealt with the security issues of Lexington Park, if I remember correctly. So are you proposing you take it out right now?
Take out this $700,000 for an entrance into it. I mean, what's that going to do for us?
Well, what they had originally done, the purpose of this originally was to open the entrance to Nicollet Park from what we'd be calling FDR Boulevard currently. It was there because of some safety issues, And there was also the ability not to have the kids just run up and down the trail to get there. So I know we had discussed this a lot in the past to get that $700,000 put in there so that the entranceway could be built. You said you're working on it right now.
Yes.
So what you would be saying is that the work that they're doing now would just be suspended.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is I don't see us having a clear path to FDR Boulevard. Why would we want to open up a road to an entrance to a road we don't own?
Privately owned, and an easement would have to be owned as well.
Suppose they change their mind, put a gate up or something.
Well, I don't think that was what was originally intended, was it?
No. Access to the park from the opposite side. But currently, you go through...
Instead of going through Patuxent Homes,
yes.
You would go...
Bunker Hill, yes.
But would you drive up that way? Would you be a parking lot and everything up there once you access...
Well, there's a connect. It would be a connector on the loop road that's currently in the park off of FDR.
So it's
familiar with where
yeah, I'm familiar with it. The key is that you want to get people out of Patuxent Homes and entering in through
using that entrance off of FDR, yes, which is a privately owned right-of-way right now.
So that goes back to the point we don't own the road, but we're designing for it, but we don't have the easement.
Right.
The easement has to be developed. But
where's the easement? Because we've worked on this for how long now?
Probably 01, I would say, when it was originally.
It just seems odd that it would take so long. Since we know this has been in there and this has been discussed, you know, repeatedly in the past.
Sure.
I have a hard time just, after the work that's been done, just yanking it out. But if that's the will of the board, you know.
Well, what's the status on the easement? Where does it stand? Does George have any information on that process or where we're standing legally for it? Maybe Phil?
Well, I think that would have
Brian
to be developed.
Probably not.
It would have to be
developed. Go through the list of names. Maybe we'll find somebody that has an answer.
Brian can help.
Oh, sure.
Brian's got the answers. Okay.
With the landowner, we've spoken with the landowner, and that's currently something that I believe they're interested in. Yes. So we will follow back through with the land exchange, the property exchange, and move forward from there, if that's the will of the board.
I would wonder aloud as we talk about FDR Boulevard in Phase 4. In Nicollet Park entrance, we're talking about the same person.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, but let's work it out. Let's get it figured out.
Yeah.
Is this seems like this is connected to what we just added for the $600,000.
Yeah. Well, Commissioner Morgan, I kind of agree with your, what's the term? Why does it take so long?
Well, I wish I knew the answer.
Yeah, why does it take so long?
Why does it take 25 years to build a road?
I agree. It just seems like it takes forever. And you allocate funding for it, but it doesn't get spent. Because you don't have an agreement.
All right, so we talked to the landowner, right, and we're going about that. What are the next steps that we have to do to get it taken care of?
So the surveying and engineering work would be the very next.
Before we get the easement, right?
Easement after that, and then design after that.
I know we don't have any design on FDR Boulevard yet, but is this entrance going to sort of play in with what we envision that roundabout's going to be for if we ever get the design done on FDR.
Yes,
and we looked at that.
The concept, yes, that concept has been discussed.
Is that we're going to put it at right about there? Or
close to there, yes. With some traffic calming devices is what the concept plan was.
Yeah.
Since you just added a phase 4 in your FDR project,
we did.
Would you like to just take care of the Nicollet Park entrance as part of phase 4 instead
yes.
of
yeah,
two
that'd be,
separate?
That'd be a better idea.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Instead of two separate
yes.
projects?
I agree. Oh, right. Yes, definitely.
So what about the construction?
So then it's part of phase 4. So this project would be removed. And as George Erickson
let's put it in phase 4 to make sure it aligns with that, as we've been talking
right.
about, that roundabout.
It has
that
to go together.
About.
Be land
make
and
sure it comes into the same area. I hope.
It's still all land at this point.
What I'm saying is
I don't want to lose the design on.
I understand.
So we're talking about moving this to phase 4, but the design for the entrance to Nicollet Park, are we talking about having that designed in phase 4 of the FDR so it all fits in?
Right.
So we're not losing what progress we already got now. I just want to make that clear.
No, that's the way I understand what you're
okay.
saying.
Okay, all right.
So
well,
we would be, just to make sure I'm clear on this, so we would eliminate this line item, the new line item we added in, we'd add the $700,000 to the $600,000 we put in there earlier, so we have a new line item with 1.3.
So the phase 4 includes land acquisition and the design of the Nicollet and the construction of the Nicollet Park entrance.
And George really wants to get in here.
I know. I
can see him.
Yeah, he's itching.
What you got for us, George?
Need a rearview mirror for that one.
The estimates that we collectively have gathered on the value of the property, one, are just estimates. Number two, there's still title searches and other things that have to get added. So before we just throw a $600,000 number, if you give us direction to put what we think we might need to acquire those pieces, that might be a little bit better.
I think that's
what we did.
That's the way forward.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But then what happens to this construction of the Nicollet Park entrance? Does that go into the phase four?
Goes into phase four.
It goes into phase four as we rework it.
To Mr. Erickson's point, I think that the $600,000 is just
a tile rum
right now versus this one's got a little more devil in the details.
So just guess, it's a guesstimation.
I just don't want to lose the ability to keep this thing moving forward.
Connection, yes.
Oh, no, we want to keep it going.
I think this retains that.
Okay. Yeah. We at Leonard Town Park now?
Can be, yeah.
What's next?
Okay, I'd like to take this out, too. We got Dorsey Park, 2 miles, 2.5 miles down the street, and we're talking about having to do a major retrofit or some upgrade to that. I know Commissioner O'Connor and you had gone out there, Mr. Lowy, and talked about trying to do something with a field, maybe a turf field or something there. Doesn't make sense we'd build something new 2 miles down the road from something we already have that needs maybe our attention now.
Yeah, I think it's two separate issues. You have a renovation of a current field there at a football facility that's outgrown. That park has outgrown what we can handle there. Parking, if you've seen it.
Yeah, I just want to add,
fairly big.
For clarification, to help you out here, part of that. Yeah, we did talk about the field and possibly a turf field, but one of the major topics that we drove around and looked at for probably a half hour was all the parking and how we would be able to move fence lines and put in bluestone if possible. It's outgrown at Dorsey. There would be lots of parking issues that we would have to take care of just to accommodate the constant play on the field between the different sports. So that was a little bit of a part of that beyond the field.
Do we have extra land there at Dorsey?
There's not much that could be used for parking or expansion of fields. That park is kind of built on ridges.
Okay.
Where fields are, where everything else is stormwater management areas and a low area there. I don't think you could expand much there. We've actually added some fields for flag football, for instance, in the back on spaces that were just green space. So we've outgrown our.
And we have the antenna going up.
And the Leonardtown Park would be on the Hayden property?
Yes, sir.
Right.
The back 125 acres behind, back left of where the current school
now,
is.
On back here, and those trees and all back in there? Yeah, would the schools use it, or how would it be used?
For recreational use,
but I mean, would the schools use it as part of their?
They have some fields that they're designing as part of their elementary school,
but it wouldn't be part of these fields.
No, separate.
Right, so okay. Different
fields. Evening use.
Okay. I'd just rather focus on Dorsey until we get it where we think it needs to be before we start doing another one. Couple miles down the street.
Yeah, we're pretty far along with this one with MHT and some MHT approvals for what phase one archaeological, phase two archaeological that we have out now, what can be done on the area, on the land itself. We got a determination that the barns could come down. We have a second one done on the former home place to determine favorably if we can use that area or not. So we are pretty far down the road with the two A&E on that.
I understand where Commissioner Hewitt's coming from with it because it is a big ticket item. But maybe if you could explain the concept behind these fields and what pressure it's going to alleviate on Dorsey Park and how you're kind of going to be moving people around once they come in there.
Yeah, I think that's the plan, is to have two additional multi-purpose fields there to take some of the stress off of Dorsey Park. Additional parking, we could add share-use parking with the elementary school, some additional parking that we will install as part of that plan. To alleviate some of the stress that's on Dorsey, so I think it is well needed.
How many fields are the $1.75 million, roughly? I don't recall. I know you said something about baseball fields, et cetera.
Probably in the preliminary, we had two lit multi-purpose fields, playground, parking lot, and restrooms. We did have some two additional baseball fields there. That may have to come forward as a separate phase, depending on how the estimates come in. An off-leash dog park. I think we would probably concentrate on the multi-purpose fields, the playground, and the parking and restroom facilities at first.
And the only reason I wanted that elaborated is because if we were to put a turf field in Dorsey Park, we're talking anywhere from $1 to $1.5 million, and then we have to displace the team that's there, and then we're still not going to be able to expand our parking.
Right.
So this is 1.75. We're getting two fields. We're having the parking. It's just down the road. Rather than putting the money into Dorsey, where we don't have room for growth anymore.
Right. I think you're at your max with parking and field use there for sure. As part of the concept plan of Leonardtown Park, it will have a section back to the right where a multi-purpose field, turf field, could go. Again, it'll be part of a concept plan, but not funded.
I guess, going back, I'd just like to know a little bit more about how, I mean, I remember the configuration when we started looking at, representative parcel of how the Hayden Field could look, or how Hayden Farm could look. I'm just trying to figure out in my mind now what is being envisioned, and I just can't put it all together yet.
Latest concept plan would have two multi-purpose fields adjacent to the property where the elementary school stops.
So the elementary school will come down the road. Elementary school's on the left.
Yes.
There's a big lot on the right that was not assigned to anybody. It's
right.
The county's property.
Yes.
So we go to the elementary school, go behind the elementary school, and then it's back on the left-hand side before you go down the swale into McIntosh Run.
Yes. Two multi-purpose fields, the latest that we've had, and that's why we had to go back through with archaeological studies, phase one and two, to where the current barns are, probably would be two baseball fields. Behind that, back left, is an off-leash dog park, a concession stand / restroom building right off of the parking area. So if you continue straight back into where the elementary school is now, where it dead ends, is where we pick up parking from there and actually swing it around. Did that help?
Yeah, Commissioner, I'm looking at numbers and costs.
I think Mr. Erickson is leaning forward in his chair. Yeah.
That just happens.
Oh, just happens.
I actually had a small graphic that I've written all over. If you want to show it to that might help.
If you don't mind, I'll take a look.
Sure.
We can certainly get you that concept plan as well.
It's a good scribble, a typical purple. Elementary school, this we haven't touched.
Yeah, that's where the houses are that he wants to pull down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the house, so that's see.
There's the elementary school and some houses over there.
Directly behind the elementary school coming from from Leonard Grant Parkway, yes.
Yeah.
So back left of that property. To give you an idea now, there's some barns that are on a ridge there as a general idea of where those fields would start.
Would,
more questions or anything?
Well, Dorsey Park would eventually become obsolete because of this, right? I mean, if you look at it that way.
No, it would just decrease the number of activities in Dorsey.
Okay.
and make it more manageable rather than having four fields go at the same time and have your max parking overflow parking used every Saturday
and, we'd be
and
looking,
evenings as well.
I'm sorry. No, I didn't mean to interrupt. We'll be looking at replacing that field in some fashion or another at Dorsey Park, though. I saw it, obviously.
A renovation?
So renovating that field, even if we're doing this.
Sure, we
so.
Renovate every single year, and the demand on that field in particular is, I mean, football is football and lacrosse is lacrosse. We build them up for them to tear them back down. So it's a constant cyclical thing year to year. And it's hard to grow grass in December when everybody gets off the fields, obviously. So that's a constant battle on every site that we maintain.
Anything else?
Okay. just want to see.
Any other, are there phasing down here, recreation and parks? Anybody? Public landings?
Yeah, well, it's the, what's with the three-notch trail, phase seven? It's 1.9 million.
There's so much federal money there.
Oh, yeah, that's we have a lot of federal money with that.
What page are you talking? Phase seven? 93? That's where we're talking?
That's a lot of federal money, that's right.
Yeah, 93, 94.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, grant money that's used, federal, state, typically is what we aim for there. To lessen the burden on the county revenue, county dollars. We've been successful in the past. We would hope to be just as successful in the future with different phasing of the trail. We based that increase on what our latest phase six of the trail came in at.
Anything else?
I do, but not at this time. I'll just get them later.
Recreation parks, anybody? Anything else? You have public landings too?
It would have been.
There's one public landing.
Derelict boat. That's a.
That's probably been taken care of. Yeah,
yearly grant.
We went through that before. Yeah, that's right. Okay.
That's all state money.
State money, yes.
And state money too.
Have you removed any derelict boats?
It's weather dependent, and it's when you have storms. So typically that's what drives it. If you have a hurricane or things of that nature, you'll get a call from someone. But it's few and far between, and the funding there has decreased.
How about old railways on the waterfront? I've seen several railways. Like there's definitely one down near Cartagena Creek, which has got some derelict boats that are just sunk in the water right next to it. Can the, you know, a private citizen apply?
Your landowner could contact DNR, and then DNR, if they'll come out and investigate it, and if it's worthy and they see fit, they'll contact David Guather, our parks manager, and then he'll contact the contractor.
Have you ever had, I'm just curious because of the homeowners that abut next to properties like that, you know, and we have this whole blight ordinance thing going downrange. Has anybody ever called in a blight complaint against a boat sunk on their neighbor's property right next door to your waterfront?
I don't know about blight, but occasionally you could get a complaint to remove that vessel.
So, but this is an opportunity that the
sure.
You could then go approach the landowner and say, hey, we could use state grant to get this out.
Yes.
So what are the repercussions? So I'm just trying to pull the string through. If I had a derelict boat on a property that I bought and sitting out front, is there an expected share in the removal of it because it's on my property in the waterway?
It has to be within the navigable water.
So it has to be below high water.
Yes.
Right.
Mean high tide, yes, in that.
And a lot of these are half in and half out,
yes,
right?
But part of it's probably in, so DNR would certainly go out and investigate.
Okay.
It's worth the phone call.
Definitely worth the phone call.
Yes.
Any other questions?
Anything else right now, guys?
Nope. Okay.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. Public school.
Mr. Lowy, thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thanks, Brian.
Let me say both Mr. Clements and Mr. Smith present their apologies, but they both had other prior commitments that they had to meet, so they weren't able to remain with us this evening. So they do send their apologies for not being with you. Okay. Would you like to go through specific projects, or do you want me to run down both of them?
I'd like to ask first, since we're starting at the top, where are we relative to getting our monies from the state? For Spring Ridge, I know we've appealed a couple times.
Yes.
Are we done with our appeals?
We are not. We have, well, yes, in the sense we are done with our appeals. We've made all of our appeal documents, and we've gone to all of our appeals. And where we stand right now, we've appealed to the governor, which is the last part of ours. And what has happened is they've issued 75% of the funding. And as a result of 75% of the funding, we're sitting at around 60-65% of the funding for Spring Ridge Middle School from the state. The anticipation is that we should receive the bulk of the money for this fiscal year. We do have the ability, because of where the project is in phasing, to carry that a little bit of that state money over into the next fiscal year if we need to. But I'm confident at 90%, which should be coming out probably in the middle of March, that we'll get another round based on our appeal. And then 100% comes at the end of the closure of the legislature.
Based upon the appeal process, and let's take the worst case scenario, that based upon the cuts that the state is making, mm-hmm. we don't get that last piece. How much money would then you guys need to finish the project that would come from us?
Right now, we have all of your county funding, which was very graciously given at the time that we had the fire. We'd have to take a really good hard look at cash flow. Where we're sitting at right now with the phasing of where the project is, we probably need another million from the state to make it work, $750,000 to a million to make it work in terms of cash flow. And I'm fairly confident, given everything that we're hearing from public school construction, it's our only request this year. Mm-hmm. So I'm fairly confident that...
I just said, from the board's point of view, the worst case scenario could be...
$750,000 to $1 million if the state were to not come through with an additional recommendation of 25% of the remaining funding.
Okay, so we'll call it $1 million for the sake of just keeping in the back of our heads.
Although, Kim, I mean, isn't the idea, though, then we'd probably get the balance of that in 17?
We would. We would get it in 17.
So it's a cash flow.
It's just a cash flow. It is just surely a cash flow, but it would come in 17.
Okay. I just want to make sure we're good.
Right. And the state is fully aware, and state has backed this project immensely. They actually this year identified an additional $270,000 of additional state funding for the project. So they've been extraordinarily supportive of the project. Last year, this time we were going through this exercise, David Lieber, public school construction director, worked with us. We should be getting that call any time now. Start working with us to see what our cash flow needs are, because they are getting to the point where they're having to start to work on individual projects. Okay. And he worked immensely closely with us to make sure that we met our cash flow needs last year. And we're anticipating the same thing would happen again this year.
Okay. Thank you.
Right. Ms. Howe, about halfway down the page, you got a new elementary school, Central County, $29,631,000. And on the following page, Evergreen Primary, another elementary school. Looks like another $18 million. Now, you're going to need two elementary schools in the same five-year period?
Well, if you look at the Central County Elementary School, that is a full-blown elementary school, and that would be a 691-capacity facility. The Evergreen Elementary School Primary Building is only a 366-capacity facility, and it's a concept that we've been looking at for a long time. And that project was actually moved out in lieu of the elementary school last year based on the need that we have at the elementary school level. But the concept that we have with that primary building is one that at Evergreen would be the first place we would do that. We would put a smaller building in. It would house pre-K to second grade. The existing elementary school would then house third through fifth. And the main reason we were looking at Evergreen Elementary School first is when that development is completed in Wildwood, all of the students will not fit into Evergreen Elementary School. We have the property there. We are allowed. It would allow us to use joint of the bus parking because it would face the two schools would face each other. We'd have joint use of the bus parking lot, and services would be jointly used on the site and make for a compact site. When we start to look at the future, we've already designed that concept into the Captain Walter Francis Duke, knowing that we could have expansion possibilities there as well. It does afford us to take the buildings up in size without having to do an addition to the building, which could be somewhat problematic. Looking forward to the future, where we sit right now, we do need a new central elementary school. Park Hall Elementary School is rapidly approaching as overcrowded as Evergreen is. Carver Elementary School is very overcrowded. With the redistricting that we just completed, Evergreen remains overcrowded. We were not able to achieve all of the redistricting that we needed to do. We knew that. That's why we had this project. So being able to pull from the southern portion of Evergreen, to be able to pull from Park Hall and to pull from Carver, this would be the formation of this new school. And it's needed in the 5 to 6 year time frame, which puts it into the plan that we currently have. Following right on the heels, Wildwood would be done. And we would need to go ahead and move forward with the primary building to round that out. We need 1.8 schools in the next 6 years. And that's based on the current projections that we have both ours and the state's are duplicating that.
Let's get to those projections. I have this CIP 2016 program, and on looks like they're not numbered, but on the third page, talks about birth rate changes, and it talks about, because I remember my days on the Board of Ed, that was, you know, 16, 18 years ago. We did talk about live births.
Yes.
And if you had a bunch of kids born in 2000, well, by 2006, they're in your schools. But what you talk about here in this chart is estimates and actuals. And what I'm seeing is that, first off, is that the birth rate is trending lower. That we're actually not getting as many children as we were. Secondly, I'm seeing that the number of kids who from birth go to kindergarten is about 90% or in the low 90s. I look here at 96, 91, and, but what I'm getting at is we're talking the out years, 15, 16, 17, 18. You're projecting 100.87, 100.29, 99.57, 98.19. Those are a lot higher than we're actually seeing. Well, if you're intending to have that number of kids born and go to school in 6 years, but the trend is 10% less, it would seem that your number of kids you're anticipating having is too high, that maybe you won't have the kids you need for these schools.
Well, it's twofold. One, if you look at it, the trend has, what this is supposed to show is that the trend has been increasing, that the number of live births to kindergarten has been increasing. The second thing is not all students come to us from within the county. We have a very high migration rate into the county. So when you look
very
at
very high what now?
We have a very high migration rate into the
okay,
county.
Why are they coming here? I mean,
they're coming here for the base.
I understand, but the base is flat. We have no really new industries coming in.
We do have a defense contracting industry, and we are getting a lot of our students. If you look at it, it's called a cohort survival ratio.
I understand, but my point is that that contractor community is shrinking. We were told by Admiral Dunaway to expect 800 to 900 of those jobs to go away. So my sense is we're not expanding. We're flat, if not contracting.
But our enrollment is continuing to increase every year at the elementary and middle school level.
It just seems to be less. I don't want to get an argument about it. But, I mean, it looks like you projected 50 more than you actually got if we look at the actuals. What did you project, 1392?
These are not my projections. These are the Maryland Department of Planning, and we do argue with them every year about these because they fluctuate them from year to year.
My point is, do you think if the trend has been going down in the number of kids being born and also the trend is lower from birth to kindergarten, I just think our projections, because what I'm looking at here in this information I got is actually next year, 15, you had a negative 67 from 14. 16, you expect a negative 21 from 15. But in 17, you expect to jump up 52. And then in 18, plus 123. 19, 143. You're exponentially jumping up at a time when it's coming down.
And this is the information from the Maryland Department of Planning live statistic data. This is what they are projecting to see. This is one set of data that we utilize. So I'm not questioning this data. I'm utilizing this data and making projections.
I guess it sort of goes back to where we were really early in the discussion when DBED had, we're getting 1,000, and we had housing starts at 450, sort of deciding whose data do we want to use to make our case.
Right. So this is one statistic that we use.
But I guess I'd still
don't
say.
I disagree with you. I'm just looking
look,
at how we do data.
When you look at these capacity needs further down, I remember this kind of stuff. Wait a minute. The point is, sometimes these numbers can be inflated. I don't think we need a new school 21, 22. And you're talking about doing two in a short period of time.
Well, in 20.
Right, including the high school.
21 is when
high school's way
21
out.
Is at we have the high school is way farther out. 21 is when we're asking for the new elementary school to open.
All right.
Can I ask a question? We look. I follow with where Commissioner Hewitt's going. And we just finished a rezoning for primarily Duke.
Yes.
And we always do this in little bits and pieces. And when would we seriously look at a countywide redistricting that affects all the schools so what we can see really where these numbers are versus it sort of being, you know, after seeing it for 4 years, It's just being, you know, done in bits and pieces.
Well, if you go to the chart that Mr. Hewitt is referencing, if you were to look at that in the presentation, all of those red numbers are where we have seats that don't exist. They're seats short. So to do a comprehensive redistricting, we don't have seats to take the students to. Only the seats that are in black are where we have seats available.
Who's programming these numbers in?
Yeah, that's what I want.
Because classroom size is subjective, and based on who you talk to, 31 students, 35 students, 25 students, so, and where to plug them in. So I guess that's what I'm looking for here.
Well, it's based on either a state rated capacity, which is how you get funded. That's how you get state funding. Or it's based on a local rated capacity that is based on how the school is staffed. Those are the two that are the precursor. And there is a whole table that says how the classes are staffed. There's a ratio of cap and goal, but there's a ratio that says how the schools are staffed. So this particular one on here is the state, and this is how we would be funded. So the state would look at it, and for instance, on Park Hall for this year, for the 2015 year, if you take their capacity into their student enrollment, they're 145 seats short. And the state would start to look at that trend, and they would come out and say that in 2021, there's 184 seats short there. At George Washington Carver, there's 73, and at Evergreen, there was 162. Now, we did add in Duke, so that would start to relieve. They would look at all of the adjacent schools, and they would start to look to see if there was enough to justify the school opening. The way it works is at the time we ask for planning approval, we have to have the majority of the students in place with the rest to come, which is 50%. So for a 691 capacity student school, we're going to be looking for 370 students to be in relocatables, because that's where they are. They're sitting in relocatables. They're either in an overcrowded classroom or they're in a relocatable. By the time the building opens, which Duke was, as we look around our schools, we look at Leonardtown Elementary and we look at Evergreen, there were 5 to 6 relocatables sitting out back, fully staffed. Those students will now move into Captain Walter Francis Duke. That's what we're starting to do now. We're starting to put students into relocatables. We're putting 2 in Carver this year and 2 in Park Hall that will be there for the beginning of next school year, in addition to the ones that they currently have. So we'll start building that population. And then we would ask for planning approval, because this is the time we would be asking for planning approval given the numbers that we have. We would then ask for construction funding in 2 years, and then the building would go into construction for 2. So in 5 years, the school would open and the population would be there and we would redistrict. We'd start to then build that population up again in the Wildwood community, and that's when we would look to do the Evergreen primary building. And that should serve us for a while. After that, we should be fine, and we shouldn't probably need a building for the next 10 to 12 years. What's happening also is at the secondary level, they're starting to rise. The bubble's starting to pass from elementary into secondary. And the process that we've looked at is and talked about is building the high school first. It's very difficult to open a high school. It's easier to open it as a middle school, transition those students from 6th grade all the way through high school into that building. By the time those middle school students become high school students, that's when we would come back in and backfill and build a new middle school, because you need the middle school as well. But you'd be using the high school to counterbalance that while you're building the middle school. And then when that was complete, you'd have your middle school and your high school in operation. A lot of school systems across the state are doing that. That's why we've been calling it the transitional school. But that high school is way out in the plan.
Yeah,
we're not looking for a planning approval out until 18. That's on page 143, and we're not asking for planning approval. Site approval in 18 and planning approval in 19, and 2 years worth of design and construction wouldn't even begin until 2021. And that's a small high school. It's 1,200 capacity. It's not a full 1,695 like we're currently housing at our other 3 schools.
Okay. So you're looking for direction today, Mrs. Kramer, or is this something we can mull over for?
Well, the key is direction so that when we come back on March 9th, we have a recommended CIP that we can take to the Planning Commission that evening, so we can get their recommendation in time for the approval on the 24th. I think one thing I would say when you talk about the schools in the out years, I mean, if you look, there were a number of changes this year, and some of that's a result of how enrollment did or didn't develop and what the needs are. You know, when I look and I see something is in for planning approval in 19 or in 18, there's 3 years of real live, not Maryland Department of Planning projections, not DBED, not anybody else, but the real live situation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The other thing, and I think, Commissioner Morgan, you mentioned it before, some of the increased costs here are because of the change in the state and local share. And that's really a reflection of a three-year expenditure trend. We'll be into another three-year expenditure trend by the time we get here. So if we do have to build it, I really think our share will increase by then. Or no, the state's share will increase by then.
One of the things that will happen is this is based on a 59% approval of the state. Next year, they'll go to 58. So that will then flatten us out. And at this point, the state is indicating 58% for the foreseeable future until we get into the next cycle. Funding does not lock in to a project until it receives construction funding approval. That's when it locks in.
I guess my only concern is after watching the school board budget for a few years, both operating and capital. The capital for the last couple of years has been shifted to the right. And as we look at the budget today, I'm pleased that, you know, we've come down on some of our numbers, but we still seem to have a big, until you redo the calculations for us, we still seem to have a big burp in 18, 19, and 20 as an aggregate set of numbers. And I want to make sure that, you know, we're really clear that it's easy to push to the right, but eventually there's a day of reckoning. Sort of, I watch the, you know, it sounds great now for Washington and the Obama administration, but after the new president comes in 16, whoever it may be, 17, they just get this doozy of a bill to have to pay. And I'm starting looking, you know, as I look at these numbers, and I said, until you recalculate where we are, 18, 19, and 20 seem like big burps on debt.
Well, that may be true, but if we have that kind of an increase in enrollment, right, we should have that kind of a growth in population, which means we should have that kind of a growth in taxes. So, I mean, that's, you know, there's a cycle to it that, I mean, I don't want to say don't worry about it, but I think the other thing to clarify is the movement to the right wasn't a matter of whether funding was or wasn't available. It was a movement to the right because of enrollment.
Right. One of the things to be aware of is as we talk about shifting them, there is a phasing to these projects because during the planning phase of the projects, in the first 2 years when you get granted planning approval, there is no state funding on those projects. They pay for construction. So one of the things we look at is the way they're currently phased, we will be a little light in asking for state funds. And if anyone has really kind of looked at that, we've always had a state request. We've always been before the state asking for funds. So the way they're currently phased, we would be asking for planning approval. We've always sort of had a project in construction and a project in planning. It worked well for us financially, and it worked well for the state. As Commissioner Morgan asked, it comes down to that cash flow and how does the state manage money. We've always gotten somewhere between $7.5 to $9 million from the state. That's what they're comfortable in our realm of getting. So we have to look if, you know, if projects were to shift to the right, what is the implication of that? If we start bunching them together, how does that affect us? Because that really truly is that kind of that magic set of numbers. We don't want to go too many years of not getting money or asking for too light of a request so that it gets bunched up. And Montgomery County and PG County have kind of gotten into that, and then they get into a point where their funding is all stacked together. So that was something when we looked at these projects, we've always tried to maintain a balance of one in construction and one in planning so that we weren't asking for too much from the state as well. So try to meet the needs of the school system plus create a balanced plan financially on both the state and county side.
You know, I'm looking at the whole thing here, and I'm looking at a new school, and I'm looking at what it's take to open up Duke. And then now the teachers want the step increases. And what
Mr. Smith has already had to gone through to be able to staff this one school while maintaining a budget. I look at a $29 million expense, and then the rest of the expenses that go with it, declining numbers, as Commissioner Hewitt had pointed out. I can't see the crisis or the demand that would require this addition right now based on everything.
Which addition?
The new elementary school for Central County that we've been talking about. I mean, is it something that what you're saying that you're adding this based on the, like Ms. Kramer was saying, the projection thereof?
Okay, now the 29 million, 12.4 of that is state funding.
517,174.
They're projecting that the Central County Elementary School cost $17 million. And the question they're requesting this year basically is, I'm assuming $50,000 for some sort of initial design work?
What that would allow us to do would be to get the educational specification done so that we can then go into planning approval in FY17. Commissioner Morgan, you're right.
So you're pushing that.
So there is that. You can do the design and you can still push the school to the right, correct?
Yes, it would be very beneficial for us to do the $50,000 to engage the architect to get the ed spec done so that we know what we're doing and have that plan well established. It definitely helps us assist us when we go to the state and have that portion of the project done.
It is sort of an initial consideration of the, I use the model, to sort of follow the evergreen model for the new central. Mm-hmm. So we're, just like when we built the middle school, Spring Ridge was adapted off of Leonardtown.
Yes.
They were considering using sort of the same model going
yes.
forward, so we're not continuing reinventing the wheel.
Right, and it allows us to go in and take a look at the lessons learned, everything we've talked about here at the table before. Look at lessons learned, look at how it's going to be sited on the new site, because, of course, it does, you know, orientation and things have to be taken into consideration, but it gives us that opportunity to take a look at that, fully develop the project. That way, when we go in and ask for planning approval, we stand much more of a better chance to get approval in that first year.
Thank you.
Because they only grant so many planning approvals, and you want to put yourself in as best possible light as you can to do so.
So it's $50,000.
And then in 17, it would be 443 for design, and in FY18, it would be 340 for design, and then we wouldn't get into construction until FY19.
But by that time, you'll have better numbers to work with.
Right. As you go through, they get refined. You continue on through the design, and then they get refined. Of course, the state does keep issuing their per square foot dollar amount, and you would hope that they would hold steady. They've been kind of going up the last couple of years. But they would be refined as we especially get into 17. We would really want to start looking at refining that number and working with the state, because they, too, want to know that we've got a refined number.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else on schools? Right now. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
There's nothing more on my agenda for tonight.
There's nothing more to your agenda, Ms. Kramer?
We were just getting started. Heck, gone. We were looking forward all night here. I was going to call out for some pizzas or something. Okay.
The Excel sheet was starting to blend together a little bit.
Yeah.
Is there anything else, Commissioners, on
that? I want to throw one thing out there. It was brought up some time ago, but the $7.5 million for the BRAC reserve. Mm-hmm. And we've kept that on the books for a while. And there are, in my mind, as I look at whether there will be a BRAC or not, I'm no smarter than anybody else, depending upon what you read and what you see. However, there's some, I believe, some projects coming down the road that are very important to the community. One is the third building at USM. Second is, as Commissioner Jarbonov discussed, the intersection of Great Mills Road and Route 5. And those are, in my estimation, you know, big things for a local community. Since I don't know where we stand with USM or with, you know, highway transportation funds, et cetera, in talking to various people in the state and up in the Annapolis area, one thing that has been sort of quasi-encouraged is helping to kickstart programs. And what are you doing to help me? Much as the governor says, you know, these projects have moved left, they've moved right. And he's on a mission, as he's been elected to do, to find ways to reduce costs. At the same time, I really believe the university system building is critically important for our future. And I also believe that that intersection at the bottom of the hill continues to be a detriment to the population, particularly as we continue to grow. So what I'm going to throw out, and I can take a beating on this one, is it was $7.5 million. I would sit there and say, we don't know what the future is going to be for the opportunity or possibilities of a BRAC. But we do know right now the USM system is real for the third building, and we do know that the traffic congestion at the bottom of Great Mills Road and Route 5 is a mess. I would possibly suggest to the board that in order to maybe get a little buy-in out of Annapolis, that we would offer up $1 million of the BRAC funds for the USM project to help them maybe move that project back into the 16 budget, because we're willing to put some skin in the game, and then maybe put 2.5 into the project at the bottom of Great Mills Road to help the state encourage them to, you know, get its movement going forward. So I'm throwing this idea out there for everybody to comment on and see what y'all think.
I'd jump in on that one. I think that's already been discussed. I think every single one of us has been discussing some potential opportunities to do that.
But I'd say to you, last week, Commissioner President Guy and myself met with Lee Starkoff from the State Highway. And what we talked about is when they do that Route 5 Great Mills Road repair, the people who are currently sitting in those queues now, that's going to be triple, four times as long if they start doing detours. So what we asked them was, is we got 7.5 that's been allocated maybe for planning on that intersection. Why don't we ask them to come back and help us extend Peg Road from Chances Run Road out to 249, that intersection. Now, one of the things that was said during the campaign, as I brought that up, that we should think about that, and one newspaper said, we got miles of wetlands. I asked George Erickson, Public Works, to come up with those plans. The miles of wetlands is 500 square feet. So it's not even near that. Mr. Starkoff thought it was a very good idea. And what he said, because what you could do, you could build that extension on the Peg Road without interrupting all that congestion that goes on right now. Because we interrupt that congestion with workers and lane closures and deviations or whatever, detours, it's going to make it a lot worse. And like Mr. Starkoff said, it's probably a 2 to 3 year construction project once it starts because of that bridge. Now, a point Commissioner Morgan made another time was that idea of that bridge being able to handle three lanes of traffic, that you could have a revertible lane in there. He told Commissioner Guy and myself that it structurally cannot support that. Mm-hmm. I don't know who else could, because I'd heard it could, I heard it couldn't, I wanted to hear it from him. But the thought would be, is if we could build Peg Road out to 249 and somehow work with the people who are impacted by that to mitigate whatever their concerns are, that we could build that road while these people are in their usual routine they're in now. And by the time we opened it, it could take 10,000 cars off of that intersection at Great Mills and 5.
I think that the biggest concern I would have with that idea has been bantered about before. If we would extend Peg Road, there's obviously issues out there with some of the landowners who have no desire to Peg Road, but we might as well just shut down Lookstone Park and forget about it. Because once you have any going out Gate 1 and you can just proceed up to Route 5, there'll be no desire for anybody to have Lexington Park live in it. We might as well just put the closed sign on the door.
I would agree with you, Commissioner Morgan. And I would say to you, opening Gate 1 is similar to the bypass that they put through Leonardtown.
Two.
two.
No, gate.
You're talking about the letter gate. Okay, I got you.
Gate one.
Yeah,
it's called gate one now.
Opening that gate up essentially bypassed Lexington Park, along with the security issues of gate two and gate three. So what we would need to do is kind of rethink Lexington Park like Leonardtown has been rethought. We'd have to make it a destination that people want to go there for. Now, am I going to say that, okay, if I'm not going down Great Mills Road, I'm going up Peg Road? I mean, you could take it out to Chances Run Road, cut over, take Peg Road out. But I guess what I'm trying to say is that it'd be a lot easier on the traffic and the congestion at Great Mills and Route 5 if we could build an alternative road that did not impact that while it's being built. And then once it was built, that congestion could be relieved by reducing the number of cars that go down there. Now, to your second point about the higher ed center, I agree. I think if that we could put money in that to move it forward or to get it backed up into the budget, I agree with that.
I agree with the putting the million into that because I think it'll definitely send a profound statement to Annapolis that yes, we do care about the third building. I think that's important. And as I think it might warrant a longer conversation about Peg Road and what the other money is there, but I think it's a great idea to invest it back into the community. So I agree with you. Whatever the solution may be down there or whatever we determine it to be. But
I'm just throwing the ideas out there because I definitely don't want to lose that USM opportunity.
No, not at all.
Or have it delayed for whatever reasons.
No.
I have no idea where the I skipped the breakfast this morning because the Tri-County Councilman, so I have no idea where the delegation sits on
They're
this.
All behind it.
Yeah. We're all behind it.
Yeah, they're
going to get all it. Behind.
So then maybe good. we could help them.
I think there were some other people there. I think Mr. Myers was there. There was other people that looking at Mr. Babcock too. Yes.
And would let just as Mr. Hewitt always says, lets us know that St. Mary's County is open for business.
Yeah. You know where I stand on the UMS.
We're
3 years behind on where we are. We are working with countries outside the United States who want that UAS technology, and we can't fly it here in the States, but they can fly it overseas. And our main systems integrators we're looking at now are down in Huntsville, Alabama, just because they have the research park, they have the capacity, and they're ready to move forward. But what we do have, because I know everyone gets sick of me talking about Huntsville, Alabama, yeah. One thing that we do have that they don't have at Huntsville, Alabama, is we have a COA with our airport. The nearest place in Huntsville to go fly UAVs is in Tennessee. So we have an inherent advantage right there. But we can't lose the bubble on this one with letting that UMS building slide. That has to go in. It is such a critical part of building our research capability down here. Because definitely the economies are there. You want to diversify the economy? Build a research park. And a key tenant of that research park is a research facility, a world-class research facility and autonomous systems.
Well, like I said, idea, throw it out there, try to get consensus and let the delegation know. Maybe they can, finagle something to help the governor with his decision making.
I think we all agree that, right?
Yeah.
We all agree.
We'll draft a consent letter for your consideration.
That's a great idea.
Good. Is there anything else? Thank you all very much for being here.
Thank you.
It's over.
Dinner done. It's over.